Okay, this is it. Blizzard have got class changes locked in for launch, so whatever insane upgrades you were bespoke or just issues left to rot, like if you're a rogue, this is what you're getting. Now, we've covered specs in depth across a few different videos, but you're not picking a spec, you're picking a class for your character, and that means today we're going to find out who's won and who lost. Either way though, you'll want to smash some spam with today's sponsor. Data and privacy in the modern internet actually spooks me. I mean, data's slurped up by data brokers, it's sold to the highest bidder, and those are probably people that you don't want to have your data. And the problem is that while we can legally get our stuff taken down, you gotta do it yourself, and that's just not realistic because we're all busy. That's where Incogni come in. They automate it for you, and code Bellular Warcraft gets you 60% off an annual plan. So click my link down below, which is incogni.com/Bellular Warcraft, to be sure to get the actual offer. Once you're signed up, they get to work right away. So here's my report: 102 takedowns sent, 81 completed, 21 in progress. And looking at those are instances where my data has not been secure, where a spammy advertiser, a scammer, or a corporation who just wants my data for some reason that I've not been told about can just go and get it. That feels wrong to me. It's bad security, and it just leads to annoying things like spam calls and texts and emails. It sucks. Now, taking a look at my graph, you can see the big spike recently. That's because you can now add up to 3 email and home addresses, which is pretty sweet, and the slow increases are them continually monitoring brokers to not only just pull my data down, but also to keep it down and add me to suppression lists so that it's not picked up again in the future. So to me, it's just a no-brainer. It takes next to no effort, and you can see for yourself at incogni.com/Bellular Warcraft where that code gets you the exclusive 60% discount. Okay, let's kick things off with the lucky and the triumphant, and of all the classes, I think Death Knights are coming out on top with the biggest glow up. All 3 hero talent trees are bringing something just pretty awesome to the table. I mean, Riders is easily one of the top 3 in the game. It's just awesome. With Sand Lane, you're getting bursts of haste, which is really fun, and Deathbringer, well, its new ability just that looks great and it's really fun. Then each spec is coming out swinging as well. 3 abilities that Blood had just clotting up the talent tree, those have been revamped into excellent tools, and the whole Bone Shield system has just been powered up through a bunch of talents, and it feels like it's got a better place. So there's that, and then Gorfiend's Grasp is pretty easy to pick up, meaning that overall Blood's just, got a great glow up. As for Unholy, well, man, it is smooth now. Runic Power and Wound Management are, I think, just much better. There are new and updated talents. And then, of course, the ancient problem of a ramping opener and a 3-minute focused damage profile. And the good news is those have all been taken care of with some new talent options to take instead of your Gargoyle and your Army of the Dead. And then as we move on to Frost, one thing's obvious, whoever was in charge of it just kind of popped off. So there are new auto attack focused capstones that add Razor Ice and Icy Talents Management for the Jewel Wheel build. Then the Breath builds, they're less about endless extension of your Breath of Sindragosa, and they're more about lining up cooldowns and buffs for just a short but deadly window. Obliteration builds then benefit from runic power generation being nerfed down a little bit, essentially forcing actual resource management back into the spec in a way that I think some people will enjoy in terms of base. And the class tree then is just a huge upgrade for all 3. They've got easy access to Soul Reaver and Abomination Limb alongside some new defensive options, and a major win is a new 4-second grace period to the Death and Decay buffs, and that of course includes Cleaving Strike for your AoE. That will be great, and the best part is that this also extends the buff whenever D&D ends, which then brings your uptime close to 100%. Then there's Empower Rune Weapon, or as I should say, the lack of it, because it's been pruned from the tree, leaving it as a frost-only cooldown, and that can sound like a nerf, but every spec has had that power redistributed into somewhere a bit more fundamental to the spec's design. And of course, that's not to mention the anti-magic shell upgrades. Overall, basically, right, it's really simple. Death Knight is an amazing class with 3 awesome specs. If you like the theme of it, you basically can't go wrong. Big result for the DKs, but second the glow up tier list is Mage. Frost's changes are tiny, but they are worth writing home about because they're quite surgical. So, talent swaps have basically opened up more AoE hybrid builds instead of the all or nothing from before. More power has been added to the non-glacial spike builds, which should keep the more like easy gameplay style of Frost just a bit more viable. And most of their upgrade just comes from having access to the Frostfire tree, which basically is just a complete blast to watch unfold. It's a pretty cool hero talent. And then we've got Fire, which I think will be truly exciting. So it's benefiting from some maintenance buffs being simplified down a little bit. There's new talents making Phoenix Flames fit better, and then some more powerful options being added for AoE, like, right, a new Living Bomb that applies automatically while they blast, which is pretty sweet. Now, Arcane, I'd say, is probably the biggest victor here. It's just had a massive pruning and I suppose a clarification with their abilities, and somehow what's happened is the dev has managed to cut away loads of excess without actually hurting the core of the spec. And that really is an achievement. You add to that then a bunch of new AoE movement-friendly talents, and they're honestly just one of the best-made specs in the game. Like, it's really damn impressive, but it almost went a little bit wrong. You see, there was an unintended interaction with spell queuing and a buff that was fun to play with. So as usual, Blizzard removed the bug. But of course, the bug ended up being fun, so after feedback, they basically added it again. And speaking of adding things, hero talent trees. Well, the Sun Fury one is awesome. It basically spawns a cool magical phoenix, and it adds a nice little spam window for both arcane and fire. The gameplay just feels crazy good. And then overall, their class utility and defensives, those have escaped mostly unscathed. There has been a little bit of a nerf cooldown to mass barrier, but I mean, mass barrier is pretty sick. And overall, I'm just left thinking that Mage is arguably the best overall class in the game. It's got three varied but strong specs to pick from. It's got a high rewarding skill ceiling if you want that. Of course, that's thanks to its defensive and movement tools, which will allow you to just shine a little bit more if you've got some more juice in the tank. Yeah, Mages, basically, they're sick. So let's go and do another big winner. And that one is Paladin. So Prop Paladin has only got some minor improvements here. There's a minor reshuffle to the talent trees that just gives it a little bit more in terms of build options. It's got a 4-second grace period when leaving consecration, which is nice. That's kind of minor, but it will be positively felt. Rat Paladin, though, it's getting a lot of love. The auto-consecration talent is baseline. Their stat scaling stuff has been addressed to hopefully fix just stat stacking and gearing issues that they have faced. Then there's a new talent that auto-procs wings from Wake of Ashes that just, in terms of general gameplay, just, like, yeah, it feels awesome whenever you use it. And like many others, they've also had the lack of hybrid builds be fixed. So talent shuffles are allowing you to pick some AoE without having a major single target sacrifice. Then, moving on to Holy, there's just been a hell of a lot of effort, and for me, this is a really big one. Blizzard have removed Glimmer, and they've given all that juice back to the Holy Power spenders of the Holy Paladin. And that basically means that they're back to being immensely strong spot healers who use Crusader Strike to build up their Holy Power. Their infusions buffing their casted spells has largely combined their melee and their caster playstyle into just a hybrid build that you can sort of talent to slightly favoring one or the other with. Now, the class tree is unchanged except for one loss, and that is Retribution Aura, which is a little bit unfortunate for, say, the second Paladin in the group, but hey, you've still got Devotion Aura. And where we're left is with Paladin being a class where you literally just can't go wrong, in my opinion. Now, I think Holy is the one that shines the most with new changes, but basically every spec here is shaping up pretty fantastically. And luckily, the hero talents are pretty damn solid too. Take the Hammers of Templar. I mean, you use abilities. Hammers rain in from the sky. Looks cool, sounds cool, does a bunch of damage. It just feels great. Then there's Lightsmith, which gives you some small support elements, which are really satisfying, and Herald of the Sun is a mostly well-themed, mostly passive light show, if that's the direction you want to go in. The last class, then, for those who are popping off, is the Monk. Across the three specs, we've had Button Bloat be addressed, some new utility upgrades, and new movement options that, I mean, just kind of feel like a mini air dash. It's pretty cool. Now, the hero talent trees are, I will say, a little bit underwhelming here, but Conduit of the Celestials is at least bursting with flavor, which is certainly good. Now, spec-wise, Brewmaster lost some buttons that they didn't like and got some new passives to improve Stagger a bunch. Basically, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, and it's a really good spec. Windwalker then has changed a bit more substantially, where Serenity is gone, as is their AoE Touch of Death, but in their place lands a huge number of upgrades to other abilities and just a stack of interactions between all of them. Whirling Dragon Punch and Strike of the Windlord get some real big additions, and they don't need to stay in their Jade Fire Stomp anymore, which again will just be nice for your playability. Expel Harm is now passive, as is Chi Wave and Chi Burst. Add to that some new haste scaling, and Windwalker is largely the same but just feels much improved. And thankfully, that holds true for Mistweaver. It's similar but with slightly less change. The big thing is that Essence Font is dead, and a few genius additions and just reshuffles to the spec tree have fixed major issues with both Soothing Mist and Rising Sun Kick focus builds. Basically now, there is a clean, satisfying core that is all about using Shilun's Gift, your Renewing Mists, and Vivify, but of course with talent options to add in extra things, like say, taking Jadefire Stomp for a real big damage to healing conversion, upgrading your Rising Sun Kicks to weave in a bit of damage while spreading some hots, or just juicing up your Soothing Mists for more directed and cast focus spot healing. With this one, the skill ceiling is still high, but it does feel great when you actually get used to not be too cheesy, weaving between all of those things. So overall, right, Monk is kind kind of like an advanced version of a paladin or something. It is emphasizing mob control a little more than, say, your personal defensives. But otherwise, it's just coming into this expansion with, thankfully, three excellent specs at your beck and call. And it's always been kind of sad. Like, Monk has always been one of the least played classes in World of Warcraft. I think never really commensurate with its quality as just an overall gameplay experience. I think now is a really great time to go and jack out Monk. Cue the melancholic music. It is time for the major losers. Thankfully, there's only two of them, but they do come into this expansion just feeling like black sheep. Unloved, unwanted, which is a shame because black sheep look honestly kind of metal. Now, the worst impacted here, sadly, is the rogue, because you guys have got next to zero changes to your deeply flawed specs, and that does cement rogue as just some of the weakest design in the game. Now, they have had some minor tweaks, things like removing sepsis and pacifying a serrated bone spike for assassination, and shadow dance becoming sub-only. And another nice change in that slice and dice is now extended in combat, so it only needs to be activated once. That's good. And that means it's time for the bad news. The immense bloat of sub is still just a thing. It's got sepsis, flagellation, secret technique, and Gormaw's bite as cooldowns, then outlaws. Many reasons to hate killing spree have of course not been addressed either. That's mostly thanks to how it forcibly just moves you and your camera around. That often of course just ends up getting you killed. And the list of things that they've got to be upset about has only really grown in this expansion. As an example, the trickster hero talent tree turns your finisher into a new ability, coup de grace, right? Which, you know, all looks kind of cool, but it locks your action bars out for a bit. That means that you can't do your off GCD things like kick. It almost makes you feel like you yourself have been crowd controlled when you see your own bars dim. Now, the others are not as negative, but basically they're not bringing a lot to the table. And this just leaves rogues in an awkward place. I think sub is the worst off here. The other two are slightly improved versions of their old self, but honestly, that's only slight enough for mains and existing fans to stick with. I think compared to the love that everybody else has gotten, well, it's just unfinished, really. That's kind of how the rogues end up feeling. Maybe a 0.1 patch is going to ride in here like a knight in shining armor and give them everything that they have been missing, but very much for the initial release, rogue feels left dying in the dirt. Our other major loser then, maybe this is just us being a little dramatic, but it does feel like it's the druid. Now, first and foremost, right, they had a gigantic class tree shakeup that didn't really shake up all that much, which compared to the trees getting upgrades, does just feel like some wasted effort. Then Moonkin has been made balance only, and I can sort of understand them doing that. They really want it to feel like its own unique thing, but I think for the other specs, it will feel a bit sad. Now, to talk about those specs, Guardian Druid has largely been abandoned here. The split between single target Maul and AoE Raise feels a bit strange compared to the other tanks, and plenty of their things that should be awesome, like say your Lunar Beam, well, they're just too weak to really bother with. And it's just odd because this was a prime opportunity for quality of life upgrades and more builds, but instead it's just crickets. Now, the hero talents may alleviate that somewhat with Illune's Chosen, but that entirely depends on tuning. At the very least, Druid of the Claw does give them the option to Catweave, which is pretty cool, but overall, it's just a bit of a loss for Guardian. On to balance then, where I've got to start off with the fun news that Tettles, a very long time Boomkin player in the WoW space, has literally called it awful in his WoWhead guide. So let's dive into what happened. Primordial Arcanic Pulsar's removal, on top of just the simplification of many different procs over the years, has kind of just cut away almost every opportunity to express skill. Like now it's two dots, starting Eclipse, and then building and spending. So for beginners and casual players, some of that may feel like a positive, right? But it does defeat the purpose of, I guess, talent trees, right? I mean, take Frostmage, okay? It is simple if you want it to be, but you can put more things into your talents and the talent tree ends up working, I suppose, to hit its design goal. Complexity comes there as an option with your Glacial Spike and your Ray of Frost. But here that doesn't happen, and hero talents do almost nothing to fix the problem. Feral, then, suffers from a different problem. In an effort to reintroduce complexity, they've slowed down the spec's energy generation to a crawl. Now, in isolation, not a bad idea. Slow down your energy, make things, I suppose, matter a little bit more so you're not flailing all over the place like a big crackhead cat, but In practice, moving on from Dragonflight, it just feels real jarring. So for new players, probably won't be a big issue because you won't really know what you were missing. And in fact, there are some benefits. It lets the core shine in a bit more of an obvious fashion. They've also removed Tear Open Wounds, the talent that enabled Primal Wrath spamming, and that does add managing rip-up time to your AoE. So you can see things there that I suppose technically are a design improvement, but I think for a lot of people, they'll find that Feral just feels slower, it feels weaker, and that doesn't feel like a win. And even their hero talent trees are fairly weak, though Bear Weaving, at least with Druids of the Claw, is a fairly cool idea. There is good news though. Restoration bucks the trend and is truly a winning spec in an otherwise losing class. Dropping Moonkin form means that they get to DPS and restore mana without shifting form, which will feel great. Then losing Luxuriant Soil helps because removing high value RNG has just let them have some more baseline power, but the loss of Adaptive Swarm will sting for some people. That, and of course having to pick between the powerful Photosynthesis and Flourish, will feel like a nerf in a few ways, but generally, right, Resto is really quite great, and in most cases it is better. And it just means that overall with Druid, they've got 3 out of 4 specs either just feeling left to languish or downgraded, which does feel rough. Like, sure, you can be a happy Resto who's got a new version of Tranquility that's a lot more, like, front-loaded in its healing, but that's not really going to make the other losses feel great. Now, there's definitely a core Druid fanbase, and this stuff is not going to stop them from enjoying Druid, but I just think the Druid is, it's due some time in the spotlight. If Blizzard were to put a whole bunch of class effort into something, I would definitely say Druid, maybe second to Rogue at least, is one of the top picks. With that said then, it's time for the little winners. These are the classes that come out with a smile, but very much not cheering and dancing. But still, if you're in this category, it is good news for you. Warrior then. Warrior is more or less upgraded on all fronts, though by minor tweaks that add up rather than anything that's like class or spec changing. So protection gets key weaknesses shored up via a little bit of extra magic damage reduction and, well, access to the absolutely fantastic thunderclap focused talent tree of the hero talents. Like, man, oh, Mountain Thane's awesome. Then for Arms and Fury, well, you guys are the real winners. There's reduced rage and proc generation in Arms that actually does mean that it ends up feeling a bit less crowded than before. I think people will like that, and most notably, Cleave now replaces Whirlwind entirely. Overpower has only got one charge, and Ravager has been added as a choice against Bladestorm. Over with Fury then, we see a similar story. Bloodthirst buffs and talents now basically give it a place in the rotation, Bladestorm is back but in improved form, and some tweaks and rebalances have just brought it to a much smoother and better overall place. The hero talents for both are actually real nice as well. Slayer buffs Execute and Bladestorm in ways that cross over well, Colossus adds a new, very cool looking but slightly controversial channeled ability called Demolish. Some people won't like it, to other people it will just feel like, well, you're demolishing people, and that will feel good. Then Fury, of course, gets access to Mountain Thane. That replaces Whirlwind with a buffed Thunderclap, which is awesome. So altogether, Warrior does feel kind of like the DKs, but maybe not as good, where you've basically got an awesome tank spec with 2 different flavors of DPS that are real fun. Next then, Hunters, who are another minor winner here, and really for a lot of the same reasons as with Warrior. We've got a class tree reshuffle that has actually removed Death Chakram and Serpent Sting, instead delivering Explosive Shot throughout the 3 specs and a new Implosive Trap and some nice utility upgrades. I think king among those for many people is going to be a 2nd charge to Survival of the Fittest for a bit more defensive power. Getting into the specs, Beastmastery's got some pretty tasty additions actually. Your Dire Beast has got upgrades that will summon in some new and rather familiar wolves, which is quite nice. Then there's Basilisk Collar. What this does is it creates a dot focus using the passively applied Beastmastery spec version of Serpent Sting and then your existing pet bleeds. Overall then, it works out quite well. As for marksmanship, you're also getting your own passive version of Serpent Sting, you're getting a volley that lets you ignore line of sight, and many, many, many much needed upgrades to things like your wind arrows, wailing arrow, and the tree pathing. Not to mention what I think is the biggest one, True Shot, because now during True Shot, you only need to fire off 1 arcane shot to use both of your precise shots, which is a genuine game changer in how that feels. Survival then, you guys have not got a complete complete rework, but it's a small rework, but it is a rework. The wildfire bomb rotating effects that were in one of your talents, those are actually now gone, and they're replaced by a new focus in the form of a passive called Tip of the Spear. Every kill command gives you a stack of a buff that your next attack will consume for 15% increased damage. And alongside some other core changes and buffs, Survival Hunter is actually just a real cracker of a spec to play. It's pretty damn good. Now, one of the keys here is that all three have had their resources rebalanced, right? So your focus generation and your procs, they basically feel way smoother to play. And it's one of those things that's just hard to communicate, but when you're actually playing the Hunter, it does feel miles better. This is still not the full rework that some people may have wanted, and their hero talents are, I think, quite middle of the road across the board, but basically speaking, it is universal improvement for the Hunters. Thankfully, Warlocks are also winners here, where impactful changes have hit all three specs, and their hero talents are mostly all good. If I was to call out one at the top, it would absolutely be Diabolist, which is all about summoning, like, major demons, and it feels excellent. To do the specs, though, I think Affliction is still the one that needs the most work here, but it still does get some nice new abilities and a shuffle tree that brings Dark Glare to the center. Shadow Bolt is less of a pain to cast if you're playing without Drained Soul, and the Hellcaller tree throws in a pretty cool stacking system onto Wither, which replaces Corruption. Now, there are some player concerns about balance here, and Malefic Rapture is still a bit of a divisive spell amongst long-term Affliction mains, but what the spec has got is less setup, faster damage, and some more tools. Destruction's been spiced up a little bit, where there's a focus and just some more varied buttons and builds. Soulfire, Shadowburn, and Dimensional Rift are now all easy to path to with the tree shuffle, and that does open up some more options. You've got access, of course, to Wither through Hellcaller, which in this case will replace Immolate, and that synergizes excellently with Cataclysm's AoE application. Overall, it's actually quite good. Demonology, though, saw a big shuffle, and it's one that opens up new builds, and the real star of this is the new Vile Fiend upgrade. It's basically you getting a full raid boss as a temporary pet, which is pretty sick. But the unfortunate thing is that Warlock did lose some baseline survivability because of Soul Leech nerfs, but they're still flooded in ways to not die. And while it's certainly been a, turbulent time on the beta, I'd say especially for Demonology, I think they're ending up with actually pretty good specs that are really fun to play. Certainly when I look at these, I would be happy to play any of them. Now, the final winner today is the Shaman, because of all the class tree reshuffles, this one actually fights with Death Knight for being the best. What's essentially happened is a lot of their existing utility is easier to path around, and it's capped off with their new solution to their defensive woes, a powerful new personal damage reduction cooldown. As for the specs, well, Enhancement was almost the victim of changes, but the dev actually took on feedback in the final hour and solved some key talent pathing issues, which is fantastic. Now, it does definitely struggle with button bloat and a few abilities that maybe don't have a great place in the rotation, but the good news is that ignoring those issues, it can now path around and make more builds that are focused on the tools that it does want to pick up. So, certainly better than we thought things were going to end up being. As for Elemental, it had a massive tree shakeup, and that just resulted in the fire build taking huge precedence with just tons of upgrades to improve it. Things like, say, Ice Fury, which is no longer an extra button, but is actually a random proc to react to while still keeping the same identity. It's pretty fun, but it's also a smart way of keeping the button bloat down. So essentially, happy days for Ellie, and then there's Resto, which got a lot of moving and shaking, but without much impact, and I'd say in a good way, actually. It's just had problems be sort of shored up. A great example there is Downpour, which is now a follow-up to Healing Rain, which is much better, and there's just a bunch of extra talents to pump up your existing abilities and cooldowns in ways that feel excellent. A good example of that is both Healing Rain and Spirit Link getting a heal attached to their activation. Now, the hero talents on top of all this are not incredible in their execution, but the fantasy, right? The fantasy of Stormbringer, Totemic, and Farseer, I think are all very, very, very fitting to the Shaman. Not to mention, of course, you guys are all getting a new raid buff called Sky Fury, which will mean that if your enhancement, something that was a bit more unique to you, is now just there for every Shaman, but basically, it's just Wind Fury with a bit of mastery for everybody. And now, the final category, those who are basically the same, with the exception of their hero talents. The first one, then, is Priest. Priest is untouched, and I actually think that's a good thing, because all three specs are effectively unchanged, but have got very nice hero talents. Archon gives you a triple halo, yes, a triple Halo, so that's pretty fun. And I'd say Oracle is just interesting to play around, but if you just want something that is gorgeous, thematic as hell, and really fun, then man, Voidweaver just looks incredible. So you've got that alongside a minor upgrade, which is that Mind Games is gone from the class tree with a 15% range increase in its place. Shadow, I'd say, is maybe the spec that could have done with some work to shore up its weaknesses and just some of its capstone imbalances, but the actual tuning changes are seemingly coming in to try and solve that. So that means that Shadow may not be the most exciting spec in the world right now, but thankfully both healing specs are just solid as hell. So I suppose it means if you want to be an AoE damage monster with Shadow and just have two really, really strong healing specs, yeah, this is a good time. And then there's Demon Hunters. You guys got changes, like getting some pretty okay hero talents and Vengeance losing their two charges of the utility sigils. And that's kind of that. On to the next class. I wish I was kidding, but I'm not. Now, they're not in the worst spot ever. It just does feel a little bit meh to move, you know, from one expansion to the other and not really get that much. Vengeance does just suffer from the same things. It's strong, it's got its fans, but their talents from build diversity to ability interactions just feel a bit behind what the better trees in the game are able to deliver. Eldrazi Reaver and Felskart are both shaping up, though, to be fairly solid hero talents, especially with Reaver's mini-game of essentially using your abilities in different orders to get either single target or AoE effects, which is actually kind of a neat idea. So look, this is not crazy exciting stuff. If you still do want to do damage in your big edgelord, then absolutely you can do that, but I would just say that as a class, there's a little bit of stagnation. And the final class is Evoker. Evoker did not get many changes, but Devastation fans lost part of the spec that they did enjoy, which was min-maxing the Dragon Rage extension. For augmentation, it actually looked like it was going to be extremely meta because of the defensive boost, but with nerfs at the last second, that is looking a little bit more up in the air. Preservation has only got a little bit of a shuffle, but the good news here is that the hero talents are really coming in strong for all three of them. Chrono Warden upgrades Living Flame to repeat healing and damage. Flame Shaper adds a whole new dot and hot emphasis to Dev and Preservation that's real fun to min-max. And then Scale Commander comes in and upgrades the main Essence Spender for both Dev and Og that just that, well, okay, look what it does is, you get Drakthyr Bomber flybys. So basically, right, you get a kill streak from Call of Duty, and I think that feels kind of cool. And with all of that said, our look through all the classes is complete. My question is, based on all of this, what do you think you will pick for your main? As for me, I'm leaning towards a few, and I'm basically going to write up a big process for how to choose a main in World of Warcraft, one that you feel like you can actually stick with for the long term rather than do the whole flavor of the month thing, because there's a problem with flavor of the month. While, yes, there often is a really overpowered spec every now and then, well, a lot of the time, for most people, you would probably just be best served being really good at playing something that is average rather than being, like, you know, mediocre or maybe a bit bad at just always re-rolling to the flavor of the month thing. So we'll meet up together. We'll try to make a real good evergreen choice. I will see you then. But till then, let me know what direction you're leaning in.